All of you are enjoying this like anything, and I'm not going to stand between you and Suchita Tai for long. Just a small request, if you already haven't, please put your mobile phones on silent mode so that and we will start immediately. This is the second day in our journey and it's a long way to go. So Suchita Tai, over to you. And as per request from all of you, we have decided to take 5 minutes break for Suchita Tai today at 6 o'clock, so that she can peacefully have some tea inside and come back to you. Suchita Tai, over to you. Namo Namaha. I'm glad somebody responded in Sanskrit. I'm really glad for that. Good. So yesterday Chetana told you that I went to US to teach. I went there in 1994, and that was a very important trip for me, not only because I went there and taught, but it changed the course of my thinking in my career. I'll tell you how. I went there in St. Paul, McAllister, and that day there was a solar eclipse. So somebody said, if you don't have a class, why don't you go to the amphitheater? There is a documentary on solar eclipse. I said, I don't have a class right now, so I'll go. And I went there. A huge, you can imagine, all of you must have seen how big the auditoriums are, and a huge screen, and all the students, all white American students, I purposely say this, and I think I was the only non-American person there. And the first shot was a rising sun on that big screen, and the first sentence of the narrator was, the first ever mention of a solar eclipse is found in an ancient Indian text called Rigveda. Can you believe what happened to me? I really started crying. I couldn't share my joy and my sense of pride with anybody around. Nobody cared, you know. Nobody cared about India. Nobody cared about Rigveda or me. But I was so happy. And I really started crying for two reasons. The first thing is, I thought, okay, so at least they know that Rigveda mentions solar eclipse, okay? And they have to admit it. So I was glad for that. And there was another reason was I was crying, and that was a sense of sorrow and disappointment. I said, okay, here at least 1,000 students heard this sentence today, that the first ever mention of solar eclipse is in Rigveda. How many of Indians know this? How many of you knew this before? Deglurkar sir. So Punya Bhushan, Professor Deglurkar, he is arrived here, and I have just started to talk about the solar eclipse in Rigveda. And so I thought that my countrymen, my friends, my relatives, they don't know that Rigveda mentions solar eclipse. And then I decided that henceforth it will be my mission and my passion to see to it that everything in Rigveda, not only Rigveda, but all the ancient Indian literature, all that treasure, I will try to take it to the common man as far as possible. And believe me, after that, I did not attend, this may be right or wrong, I don't know, but I did not attend a single conference. I wrote papers, I wrote articles, but I thought, why attend conferences? Everybody knows Sanskrit there, you know. I mean, there is only one detail or one other important thing that they say. And I started giving talks on social platforms. And this I find very important. Even today, let me tell you that even if a Mahila Mandal asks me, can you come and talk about Rig Veda, but we are only 10 people. I said, doesn't matter. It is, the knowledge is multiplied by 10. You go back home, I'm very sure yesterday when you went back home over your dinner, you said at least a couple of things to your family, right? So it spreads. It definitely spreads. And from that day, I have decided to do this. Anyway, so coming back to this solar eclipse, how does the reference come in the Rig Veda, in Rig Veda? I told you yesterday how the entire Rig Veda is classified into various mandalas or chapters, mandalas. The fifth mandala is ascribed to a rishi called Atri. And Atri tells you in one of the suktas, he says, Yatva Surya Suvarbhanu Tamasa Vidyadasuraha. He says, O Surya, this very powerful Suvarbhanu, by the way, Asura does not mean a demon or Rakshas. Asura means a man with a lot of physical strength. And so he says, this Suvarbhanu, so there is someone, another person, no, sorry, not person, another Jyotirgola, as we would call it, another star or planet, he doesn't mention that, but Suvarbhanu, someone in the sky who has covered you with tamas, and tamas is shadow. So he describes the solar eclipse in the best possible way that you can describe it in a poem. And the intention is not to describe the scientific way how the solar eclipse occurs. The intention is to say how great Atri is. And then Atri realized what was happening. And Gulab Suryam, the sun was hidden, Gulab, it was hidden. And what Atri did was, within a very short time, he saw to it that the sun shone again. It started shining again. So just imagine that this reference is in Rig Veda. Who would believe this? Who would believe that? And it doesn't say that Rahu or Ketu, somebody came and swallowed the sun and moon. They never say of that. They only say that they cover the sun with tamas. There is absolutely no misunderstanding or no two ways about this. This tells you a lot about their knowledge in astronomy and astrophysics. I'm actually scared of talking about physics today since you're right in front of me. But whatever Rig Veda says, I would definitely like you to know. You will be surprised that Rig Veda knows that the universe is heliocentric and not geocentric. What do you mean by heliocentric? That the sun is at the midpoint and the entire universe roams around it, revolves around it. Whereas geocentric is the idea which people had in the West till Galileo came and told them that no, Earth is not the center of the universe, it is the sun. But our people knew it as back as 2500 BC, and as I told you yesterday so many times, that when 2500 BC, Rig Veda was ready by then, Samhita was ready, which means the suktas were written even before that. So we are assuming that it took at least, I mean, whatever we say belongs to 5000 years ago. So at that time they knew this. And as you start reading Rig Veda from this point of view, you realize that their knowledge of astronomy was amazing. They, of course, know sun and moon and earth, everything, forget about that. Prithivi, they know Prithivi. In fact, whenever they praise any god or goddess, any deity, the first thing they say is, oh, you are great because you separated earth from the sun. You are great because you separated earth from the sky. So they know that sometime, long back maybe, they were near each other and now they are separated. Secondly, when they talk about all this, the greatness of sun or the earth, they keep telling you that earth was, now this is a very funny simile they give, they say the earth was rolled out, but it was rolled out, म्हणजे चक्कर लाटणं घेऊन म्हणतो ना, in that fashion, but it did not become a square, it was a sphere. What is the word for geography in Sanskrit or in Marathi? Bhugol. Did you ever realize that we talk about gol? We never talk about a square or rectangular earth. We always talk about a spherical earth.
I'm really sorry, we are pausing for 5 minutes. There seems to be some technical problem with the webinar, and there are 40 odd people watching this on webinar, so they are not able to see. So just give us 5 minutes. Sorry about it.
काय करू?
काही होत नाही. बोरीचं वायफाय पण स्लो आहे. कोण पाठवत नाही, खूप स्लो आहे. स्पीड टेस्टला पण जात नाही. बोरीचं करून
बघतो. बोरी करून बघा. बोरीची आत्ता काय बोरीची बाकीची बनले.
करंट इंटरनेट स्पीड 0 kbps. परत स्टार्ट स्पीड टेस्ट. हां 186.18 आणि 23.27. ठीक आहे का? हां MBPS 186.18 MBPS. ठीक आहे. लुक्स लाईक इज स्टोर.
कशावर गेले? बोरीवर.
बोरीवर रिलोड आत्ता केलं.
सॉरी नाही, नो प्रॉब्लेम.
आय थिंक सुरू झालंय. तुम्ही बोलायला लागा म्हणजे मला कळेल लोकांना पोहोचलंय की नाही.
ओके सो आय नो द लिंक वॉज ब्रोकन इफ यू बट दॅट्स ओके. सो वेन दे कम अँड थिंक अबाउट ऑल द प्लॅनेट्स अँड स्टार्स, you know that our knowledge about all these things was way superior and way advanced than many other cultures and civilizations in those periods. You will be surprised. I mean, even when we are small and we don't know anything about how the sun moves and where the earth rotates and revolves and all those things, what are we told when the sun sets? Our parents tell us that it has gone home. The sun had set, it has gone to its home. The Vedic Rishi doesn't believe that. A friend, I mean he is a Rishi, but a friend asks another friend, when we go to sleep, that is when it is night here, katamam dishi rasmi rasya tatana, in which direction does sun give his light? So just try to imagine that they never thought that the sun disappears from the sky forever, and that is for 12 hours or whatever, but they think that it has gone somewhere else and the sun is giving his light and heat to some other places. If they can think of that, you can imagine what their idea was. Very surprisingly, they also know a lot about moon. You know the word for moon, not in Sanskrit, but in Mundal, that is non-Aryan languages, is Ma. Ma is moon. So what do we call the lunar month? Chaitra Vaishakh, Maas. So that which is counted by the movement of moon. How do we say full moon day? Purna Ma. Purnama. It becomes Purnima later on, but it is Purnama. And no moon day is called Ama. So you will know that they know everything. Not only that, they definitely knew that there was the velocity of earth and the velocity of moon. Why do I say that? Because suppose they are going to have an Ashwamedha Yajna. It starts always on the Chaitra Purnima. And 1 year before that, the first ahuti has to take place. It starts 1 year before that. Can you tell me what will be, today it's 2nd October, what will be the tithi or even day on 2nd October 2020? We don't know that. But they knew. They could calculate backwards and forwards, find out the tithi, and believe me, even today for me and for all of you, I take it on, I almost assume, with some exceptions of course, that it is so difficult to read what we call panchanga. We don't know how to read that. Sayana, Nirayana, we just let it be and we look at the English calendar that, oh, it's 23rd July, that's fine. So this is how they used to know. I mean, these are some of the proofs that we know that they knew a lot about that. They also talk about constellations. What is constellations? Nakshatra. In Rigveda, there is a mention of, I think, 11 or 13 constellations. But later on, in Yajurveda, there is a list of 27 constellations. Now, just imagine, if you know constellations, and if you mention 11, which means the remaining you know already, but you are mentioning only these many. So, if you know them, you know that the imaginary path of sun in the sky, that it is divided into 27. We know how the nakshatras or constellations are made. So they knew all this, and it shows in all their suktas and mainly in their rituals. Because for rituals, they start even today. Our rituals, our festivals, they start on a particular what we call tithi, right? I mean, just now in the morning, I was looking at the calendar and my calendar is Kala Nirnaya the Great. So I completely rely on that. And then I saw that in the morning, it is, I think, Naraka Chaturdashi, this one Sunday, and evening it is Lakshmi Puja. I can never understand this, but I follow that because I am unaware, or rather I am ignorant of the movement of earth, moon, and the rotation and revolving of the earth. One very good thing is they had different ways of calculating time. Time in the sense calendars. Even today in India we have different types, right? We have Saura, we have Chandra. Chandra is the one we generally follow. Saura is followed by Indian government and schools like Prabodhini and all. And otherwise, people follow Gregorian calendar, that is January, February, and all. They have, well, you know the word Samvatsara. So they have something which is called Samvatsara. Then Parivatsara, Vatsara, Idavatsara. So there are different ways of calculating calendars, and we are not exactly, we don't know what exactly they mean by that, how the calendar went. But there is one more interesting thing. The counting of the year started with different months in different calendars. I'll give you an example and then you would know this. How do you wish anybody on the birthday in Sanskrit? These days everybody says, Jive Sharadaha Shatam. Sharada, as you know, is autumn or a season, right? It's not a month. And may you live for 100 autumns, which means may you live for 100 years. And now what do we say? Shatamu Hemantan, Shatam Vasantan. There are different calculations for that also. And now what do we say? Shambhar Varsha Ayushya Labho. Now what is Varsha? Varsha is Varsha, rainy season. So there was some calculation which started probably with Hemant, some with Vasanta, some with Sharad, and many others with Varsha. Now the name has stuck. Even if the calendar doesn't start with, Chaitra doesn't come in the rainy season, but we still use that. And now I'll tell you the best thing in Rigveda, which tells you a lot about their astronomical knowledge, which itself is really astronomical. There is one very funny word in Rigveda, which is Marimlucha. Now this word itself doesn't sound Sanskrit, And marim in Sanskrit, typically, if there is one word, there are many words which are similar in formation to that. For example, suppose there is Shastranya, then you have Tatvajnya, Sarvajnya, Ajnya. So you have a particular pattern how the words are formed. So here, marim lucha is a word which has no similar counterpart. And what is marim lucha? Can you guess? Marim lucha is the 13th month, Adhik Mahina. And what is Adhik Mahina? What is the 13th month? How does it come? Every 3 years we know that it is the difference between the solar calendar and the lunar calendar. So just imagine that they knew both the systems, they knew that there will be a difference, and so every third year they would have the 13th month. They also knew which month would come when as a 13th month. So that all this shows you their knowledge about astronomy. And this knowledge is later on reflected in, unfortunately we don't have those books with us now, but in Varaha Mihira and Aryabhatta and all these people, we have that. Now my question to you is, how did they know this? That they were intelligent is one thing to say, but to calculate all this, to know the distance, to know the time moon takes to go around earth or whatever, you need some aid, some calculators, some telescopes. We have no idea how they did that. You will be surprised. They talk about a lot of constellations and many other stars, star clusters as we say. For example, they talk about Saptarshi, Ursa Major. And not only that, they also talk about, there is a star, Vasishtha. Near it, there is a tiny little star, which is called Arundhati. And according to Ayurveda, so long as you can see Arundhati, your eyesight is fine. Okay, so that is a tiny star. And they know that. And they have given the names of seven rishis to those seven stars. How did they know that? I have really no answer to that. Probably they must have had some aid. And as usual, the foreign invasions or probably maybe a natural calamity or something wiped away everything from Bharatavarsha. We have no idea, but the proof remains in the literary text that they knew a lot of astrophysics. Yesterday, I think you asked me about the oral tradition. And I told you that I'm going to talk about that today. So just imagine, why did this knowledge survive? And why did many other texts, about which we just know them by their names, we don't have the entire Varahamihira Samhita with us, you know, or Aryabhatta, or many other. There is one text by Lagadha, which is called Vedanga Jyotisha. And by Jyotisha, they don't mean astrology, they mean astronomy. So that text also is not available to us in its complete form. So all that is lost to us. You just cannot imagine the loss we have suffered because of the foreign invasions and many other reasons too. And then how it is that Rigveda survived? How it is that Rigveda survived in exactly the same way in which it was composed 5,000 years ago? Can you imagine why? Because Rigveda was not written down. I mean, it was written down later, but there was a big oral tradition, as it is called, Maukika Parampara, by which Rigveda was transmitted from teacher to the student, from that student to the other students. And this is how Santha, you must have seen, you must have seen the serial Chanakya. Remember in how there they have shown the Veda Pathshalas. That was precisely the way knowledge was transmitted in those days, oral transmission. And what do you mean by oral transmission? There was no written text, we saw that yesterday. And so, suppose there is this first Rucha by Madhuchandas Vaishwamitra. दॅट्स द नेम ऑफ द ऋषी. अग्निमीळे पुरोहितम यज्ञस्य देवम ऋत्विजम. आय वोंट इवन गो दॅट फार. अग्निमीळे पुरोहितम, दिस इज कॉल्ड संहिता. यू नो दॅट यस्टरडे वी सॉ व्हॉट संहिता इज. सो फर्स्ट द गुरु विल आस्क द स्टुडंट टू रिपीट दिस. अग्निमीळे पुरोहितम, it is chanted to three accents. I wouldn't go into that just now. Then just to know how to break the words, you have to say agnim, pause, ire, pause, purohitam. So I know that there are three different words, agnim, ire and purohitam, and this is very important. This is called yati and shabda cheda pada cheda. Why? Because if you don't do this properly, the meaning changes. You will remember the famous example Pu La Deshpande has always given, that there was a boy in his class whom everybody called Bhadak Makar, and he always used to get annoyed because he would say, I am Bhadkamkar, but they would all say Bhadak Makar. And such things happen, you know. Once I got a phone call by a very learned person, but not from Sanskrit field, and he said, what is mruchha? I said, mruchha, I don't know this word. So I didn't tell him I don't know this word. I said, where did you come across this word? What is the context? And he said, oh, you don't know. I said, no. He said, see, I know kati is the waistline of a woman, and then what is mruchha? So he thought that mruchha is one word. And Katika is, you know, the famous name Mruchha Katika, right? And then I had to explain. I said, no, this is now not how you break the word. You have to say Mrut and Shakatika. Shakatika is a small chariot or a play cart actually, and Mrut is clay. So if you don't split the word rightly, you would never know anything. And therefore that is important. So this is called Padapat. Then we go to krama. Krama is sequence, we know the word. And then how do you go? Now I would, instead of saying Agni Mile, I would say ABC. So first is ABC, then it is ABC, right? And the second one is AB, BC, CD. So I know exactly what comes before C and what succeeds C. And then you go like ABCCB, BCDDC. It is amazing. The way they have designed this is a foolproof method of oral transmission. It is so foolproof that in Rigveda, there is not a single what we call variant reading. There is no room for that, you know. Everybody says the same thing all the time. Even in Kalidasa, we have these variant readings. So in Meghadutta, people would say, oh, it is not Ashadasya Prathama Divase, it is Ashadasya Prashama Divase. And then there would be some discussion. Forget about that. But such things never happened about Rigveda. And we have taken a cue from this. All of us, at some time in our life, especially when we are small kids, we learn Indian classical music, all of us. And you remember the alankara? Sa re re ga or sa re ga ma pa. So this is how we go, and we don't realize what we are doing there. That time we don't realize that. What we are doing is actually making sure that re comes in between sa and ga. And so this is how entire Rigveda was transmitted. And you will be surprised, all those young students, disciples I would say, all those young disciples, they knew everything by heart, they memorized everything. The only problem was, not all of them knew the meaning of each and every word. But if you ask me, that doesn't matter. I mean, of course, if you know the meaning, it is better. But if you don't know the meaning, and if you still memorize the entire text, it is still better. Tell me, most of you you chant some stotra or other. Many of us know Ram Raksha, right? When you say Ram Raksha, do you know the meaning of Atta Sajja Danusha Vishuspurusha? Just tell me frankly, or that we don't know the meaning, but even then we chant that. Even then we chant the stotra, and that has some effect on us. So the chanting of Rigveda not only had a good effect on the minds of teacher and the disciples, but I am grateful to them, because it is because of them that Rigveda survived. And that is why we really must thank all these great people, the chanters, those who transmitted orally the entire text of the Rigveda. When I was in TMV, there was one Shastriji, I forget his name, I think his name was Yerodeka Shastri. Was there one Yerodeka?
Yes.
And he would, you know, he would ask us, we were young, and he would say, okay, tell me whichever Rucha I should sing. And suppose I say, okay, sing the third Rucha from the fifth Sukta of the eighth Mandala, whatever comes to my mind. And before I could open and verify which Rucha it is, Yerodeka Shastri has started it. And that was so amazing. I mean, just imagine, we, yesterday also I told you that we don't remember even small things, and these people remembered the entire text by heart, and they chanted it and preserved it for us, and that is why I am thankful. I told you that Rigveda, even today, is relevant. And there are so many things that happen about it, and we are not aware. Just as we didn't know that solar eclipse is first mentioned in Rigveda, we don't even know what happened to this oral tradition. In 1991, UNESCO decided to give some, it's not actually a reward, but you know, to give a list of the best, you know, they talk about World Heritage now. So after World Heritage, they decided to talk about the Oral Heritage. So which is the best Oral Heritage? The second number goes to, if you have read the novel Roots, where in Africa, there are these historians who just say, what is your name? Okay, Katharina Kindler. And they would start telling you all your history. They just know it, you know, they have memorized it. And that's a huge thing, because that retains the history and it is important for you. And the first number goes to the oral transmission of Rigveda. Just imagine how many of us know this. How many of us know this? And I always feel, you know, that we always want to discard something which we don't even know what it is. All this time we say that, oh, Rigveda is not my cup of tea. But do you know what is Rigveda? Do you know how it was transmitted? Do you know what kind of efforts these people have taken? And so Rigveda, because of the oral tradition, survived. You will be surprised that whenever there were foreign invasions, you know, the first thing the victors do is destroy your culture. Destroy the culture of the natives, whosoever are there. And what they did was, they set on fires the libraries. You know, there is one Chinese traveler who has said that one library, and the word for library in those days, Sanskrit, it's Saraswati Bhandara. What a beautiful name. So that Saraswati Bhandara was burning for 3 months. So just imagine the amount of manuscripts they had. And why it was burning for so long? Because all manuscripts were written on palm leaf and birch leaf. And therefore, you know, they did not catch fire. They were just smoking and smoking, and that is how they were destroyed in 3 months. Doesn't matter. We have a tradition of Rigvedic chanters who kept the Rigveda alive for us. And that is why this is important. One very good thing which I told you that we use so many words without even thinking about the real meaning of those words. For example, we say, amcha vangmay thore. Vangmay. I mean, this word Vangmay is used so many times. Do you know what is Vangmay? We translate it loosely as literature. Vangmay is Vak plus Maya. Vak is Vani, speech. So anything which is transmitted by oral tradition is called Vangmay. And therefore, if you ask me, Rigveda is one of the few Vangmayas in the entire world. Something which is printed, something which is typed, is not Vangmaya. It is Sahitya, all right, but you cannot call it Vangmaya. So this is how the oral tradition helped us to preserve Rigveda, and we are thankful for that. Yesterday, we talked a little bit about suktas from Agni, Indra, etc. And today I want to go into details of some wonderful suktas from Rigveda. About Agni, let me tell you one thing. This first sukta, Agni Mile Purohitam, it's only 9 ruchas, you know, but it is so amazing. Just see how the Rushi feels on a familiar footing with the god Agni. I mean, he is so frank with him, you know. He says, I told you, I'm giving you Ajja, so what are you giving me? And then in the last one, he says, Sanav Pite Vasunave Agne Supayano Bhava. O Agni, bring some gifts for me. Just as a father brings gifts for his son, his child, similarly. And I thought, look at this, their family life. When the father comes back from home in the evening, from his field or whatever he was doing, he brings maybe a Cadbury or whatever, doesn't matter what he brings, but he would always bring some cow for his children. And this is very important. So not only this, but the way they talk to the gods shows you that they are very close to each other. And there is not only friendship, but there is also beginning of bhakti, of devotion, which we see in Rigveda itself. We will do that when we go to Vasishtha and all. About Indra, I told you yesterday how his brave deeds are praised in ballads. Ballads is Povada. And in these ballads, every time you come to know a lot of history, because they give you names. Alinasa, Balanasa, Shigru, Bhujju, Tugra. There are so many names of kings, you know, which we come to know because only because of Indra ballads, which mention the acts of bravery. And therefore, Indra ballads are very important, not only for the characterization of Indra, but also for the sake of Vedic history that we come to know through that. Indra has so many suktas, you know, so many suktas are addressed to Indra, and they are so amazing. I told you a couple of them yesterday, but there are some which are so beautiful. There is one female Rushi, as I told you yesterday, that there are women who also wrote suktas. One of them is Apala Vishwavara. This Apala, she could not get married. Whatever reason, that is not given there. She didn't marry, spinster. And she, when she was walking on the street, she met Indra. I told you, Indra was a human being. He was a person like you and me. So when she met Indra, she praised him. So he was very happy and he said, okay, ask for blessings. Ask for boons, actually. These are some typical words which Sanskrit scholars would always translate into. Var is always translated as boon, and nowadays people don't know this word, so I would say blessings. He said, ask for blessing. And you know what she asks? She's staying with her old father. And she says, Imani Trini Vishtapa. There are 3 things in our house which do not yield any fruit. Make them fruitful. So Indra says, okay, what is it? So she says, the first is the barren land around my house. There is no, the land is not good. So I cannot grow anything in that. So make that fertile. Indra says, okay. Trini. Trini is, there are three places. The second one, what is the second one? She says, my father is bald. So let see to it that he gets hair on his head. I tell this to you because I want you to know again and again that Rigveda is full of human emotions too. We saw philosophy, we saw knowledge, we saw everything, but even these things are important in Rigveda. Indra says, okay, granted. And what is your third field which is barren and I should do something? What does Apala say? She says, oh, my womb, you know, I haven't had a baby. I want a child. So what she's asking is that I want to get married and I want to have a child. And Indra says, okay, that apart. But just see how bold the women were and how they were smart. See the sense of humor in all this. Imani Trini Vishtaba, the way she talks to Indra is really amazing. So I won't talk much about Indra today because we have already seen some of his suktas. But then I do want to talk about some particular suktas from Rigveda without which we cannot go ahead. I mean, you must know about them. That's what I feel. One of them, I told you that there are many suktas about religion, philosophy, culture and everything. But there are also some suktas which are secular in tone. And what do I mean by secular? They are not addressed to a particular deity, a god or a goddess. But they are experiences of that particular rishi. For example, in the 10th mandala, 1034, is a famous sukta called Aksha Sukta. You know what is Aksha? Can you even guess? We know words like Draksha, and I sincerely believe that there that word Aksha stays. Rudraksha, we know that. So Aksha is a fruit, Beda. It's a fruit of Beda with which the Vedic Aryans used to play dice, Dyuta. Okay? The game was entirely different, that there used to be 150 akshas and, you know, there used to be a kind of a ditch in the ground, and somebody has to throw those 150 akshas and keep some away, and the other party has to tell whether the remaining will be completely divisible by 4, or 3 will remain, or 2 will remain, or 1 will remain. This is gambling, right? So this is gambling. And there are names for these games, I'll tell you. So this person, his name is Kavasha Ailusha. As it is said that whenever there is a show, the retroflex show, that is Potpodya show, in a Sanskrit word, that is not native to Sanskrit, which means it belongs to some other language and has been introduced into Sanskrit. So this Kavasha Ailusha is called a Rishi because he composed the Sukta. He has no other characteristics of a Rishi. And what is this Sukta? It is so beautiful, a monologue, you know. It's all first person singular. Pubha Bhave, a Marathi author, he wrote his autobiography. And you know what is the name? Pratham Purushi Ek Vachani. I just love this name as much as I love that book. So this is also Pratham Purushi Ek Vachani. It is his experience which he tells you. And now just see, he himself is a gambler. He himself has lost so much in his life. So when he says something about, or rather against the dice, against Aksha, it carries a lot of weight. And you know how he says? He says, oh my God, you know, in the morning, I decide. I'm quoting now. In the morning, I decide that in the evening when my friends come, I'm going to refuse. I will not go to Dyutashala. I'm not going to play dice. Now, instead of dice, you can put any other thing to which you can get addicted to. You can say a glass of alcohol, you can say horse racing, you can say cards. I know people who play cards all over the weekend without even sleeping. So you can say anything. Akshar, it just happens to be there because he played Akshar. So he, and everybody decides this. When you want to wean off from your addiction, you decide, oh no, this is the last glass I have. So he says the same thing. And he said, oh, what can I do? In the evening, you know, they make the dice. The Akshar makes such wonderful noise, because imagine 150 Akshars, their sound is resounding. And he says, I love that. They actually pull me towards Akshashala. This is exactly what happens. You know that certain thing is wrong, but then you are pulled towards it because you don't have enough control on your mind, whatever. And then he says, because of this, you know what happened? My wife actually was very sweet. She was friendly to me and to my friends, which is so important, because it's mostly the friends who are responsible for you getting addicted to anything. But she was nice to them. Shiva is the word. Shiva sakhibhyaha uta mayam asi. She was nice to me too. But because of my behavior, she got angry and she left me. And before she left me, Shivashru, my mother-in-law came. And this is so typical. The mother-in-law scolded him, which is natural. I mean, if the daughter is getting trouble, she would come and scold him. And all this he tells you. Then he says, okay, so they left me. Not only that, my parents told. Because, you know, he took loan. He could not pay everybody. He took loan, which he could not repay. And there were no karza maafi in those days, you know, like we have today. So he had to pay. And for that, he had taken loan. So the soldiers from the king came to him, came to his house. And the parents said, Nayata baddhametam na jani maha. We don't know him. You tie him up with a rope, do whatever, put him in jail. We don't know him. And I'm surprised, you know, even today, once in a while in newspapers, you see such things that if so and so asks for money, we are not, he is our son, but we are not responsible for that. So he says that, Nayata baddham etam. Then he says, so I decided, I can't get money. So I better do some robbery or something, theft at least. So he goes to a house in the evening. And what does he say? When he peeps through the window, he sees that Sukrutam, the house is so well made, and the family is sitting together, laughing, eating. He said, I felt sorrier for myself. Even I had a family. What did I do? And why did I do that? Only because of the game of dice. And in the end, there is one verse which I must tell you, because it has impact on Mahabharata too. He says, Anye jayam parimrushanti asya. When there is a gambler, other people can come and touch his wife. They can take advantage of her. Why? Because she has nobody to protect her. And I thought, didn't Yudhishthir know this? He must have learned Vedas, right? And didn't he learn this particular sukta? He should have known, and he should have stopped playing Dyuta. Anyway, that is something entirely different. But he said this. And in the end he says, I really have no money. And he keeps his hands open. And he says, look at my hands. I have absolutely no money. And then he does the best thing. He gives us advice and he tells us, Akshayhi ma divyaha. Akshair ma divyaha krushimit krushasva vitte ramasva bahumanyamanaha. Which is so important. He said, don't play with the dice. And as I said, it is dice or horse racing or whatever. Don't play with the dice. अक्षय कृषिम एत कृषस्व स्टार्ट प्लाविंग युअर फील्ड्स यू नो दैट इज डू अ डिसेंट एंड नोबल जॉब अर्न युअर मनी इन द राइट वे विते रमस्व एंड वॉट एवर मनी यू गेट बी हैप्पी विद दैट थिंकिंग बहु मन्यमान दैट दिस इज अ लॉट फॉर मी वॉट हैपन्स इज वेन यू चेस मनी वेन यू गो आफ्टर इट यू ऑलवेज ट्राई टू गेट मोर मनी बाय डिवियस वेज by sinister ways and therefore this particular hymn I love this particular sukta I love very much because it tells you about the social conditions of Vedic times I told you there were some bad and evil elements even in Rigveda even in Rigvedic times one of the Surya suktas for example there is a sukta addressed to Surya and he says oh Surya When you arrive, two things run away. Two people run away. Who are they? First is nakshatrayanti aktubhi. When your rays come in the sky, first thing that runs or disappears is the nakshatras. I told you that all the stars by nakshatra, they don't always mean constellations, but stars. So the stars run away from the sky and अपत्ये तायवो यथा एंड ऑल्सो तायु तायु इज अ थीव वेन देर इज सनराइज वेन देर इज लाइट द थीव्स हु हैव बीन एक्टिव ड्यूरिंग नाइट दे ऑल्सो रन अवे एंड डिसअपीयर सो वॉट आई थिंक दिस इज ब्यूटिफुल बिकॉज दिस इज दिस गिव्स अस इनटू अ डीप इनसाइट इनटू द ऋग्वेदिक लाइफ So this particular sukta, I would say, is entirely secular. It has nothing to do with any deity. It has nothing to do with any religious faith or philosophy. But even then, this is more important than many other suktas. It is not that the suktas are always about deities and some such things, you know. There is one sukta in Rigveda in the 8th mandala, which is a puzzle. There are 8 ruchas, rooks, and it goes like this. Just as we give puzzles to our small kids and all, you know, that I am tall, I am brave, I hold a vajra in my hand. Who am I? The answers are obvious, of course. I mean, it is Indra and all. I have flames, I shine all through the day. Who am I? It is not what the puzzles are. It is the idea that there are different types of suktas in Rigveda. And one of them, and very important, is what we call Akhyana Sukta. Akhyana Suktas are also called Samvada Suktas. You know Samvada, right? Akhyana is a story. Samvada is conversations or rather dialogues. So there are stories, there are 20 such Samvada Suktas where stories are told through conversations, through dialogues. And you know how they go? Like the Sukta itself will have only dialogue. Pururava says this, Urvashi says that, Pururava says this, Urvashi says that. I mean this is everywhere. I only talked about Pururava Urvashi. It could be Saramapani or any other, Yama Yami, there are many Suktas. But the thing is, the narration differed from place to place. If they came to Pune, the narrator would say things which Pune is would like. If they go to Mumbai, they would say something entirely different. So narration differs, and this happens even today in our folk art. Like Vogue, Tamasha, you know the narration changes. Many of you must have seen the wonderful folk drama by Dada Kondke, Vichha Maji Puri Kara. Every time the narration will be different. The songs are same. The main conversation dialogues are same, but this will differ. The best, and by the way, from this is the source of the great tradition of Sanskrit drama. Sanskrit is famous for its dramas, and we find the roots in this Samvada Sutra. The best one I like, and I'm going to talk about that a bit, is Vishwamitra Nadi Samvad. You can guess what it is. It is Vishwamitra on one hand and Nadi rivers on other. There are two rivers. So Vishwamitra has just won a battle and he has come with the soldiers. They are on the side of a king called Bharata. So just see, Bharata is that old. And so they come with us, he comes with the soldiers on the banks of confluence of two rivers. Vipat Shutudri Payasa Javete. Vipat is Bias, Shutudri is Satluj. So they are somewhere in Punjab and they say, he says that, oh, what wonderful rivers. They are like two horses running together. Oh, they are like, you know, a calf and a mother. They lick each other. They are so loving. They are so beautiful. So this and so that. Because he wants to cross the rivers. He is standing there. The rivers are no fools. They say, Kimyur vipro nadyo johaviti. Why are you praising us so much? What do you want? Tell that in clear terms. Don't go beating about the bush. Tell us what you want. And then he says, and then he says, you know something, you should please lower your water level because we want to cross. The army is tired and we want to cross. Now just see, this is metaphorical, okay? And not that the rivers actually spoke, but it is written so beautifully. And they say, okay, we will. But then what will you give us? Why should we do that for you? So just see how the conversation, and the language is so simple. Spoken language is always very simple and meaningful. So the language is simple. And then he says, what can I do for you? And they say, oh, you say that you are a great poet, right? Why don't you write a sukta and use our names in that so that we will be immortal? And really they became immortal, you know. The Vipat Shutudri Payasa Javete is a verse which everybody loves. And then they lower, but of course, before that, they are women. They don't do anything in a straightforward way. They say, but we can't do that. Because, you know, Indra has asked us that we must flow on continuously. Then he said, please don't do that. I will write two more beautiful poems on you. And then they say, okay, let's consider. But Savita has done this for us. And then he said, okay, I'll do this for you, that for you. And this is how the story goes on. And they lower down the water and Vishwamitra crosses the river. The story is not important. The story I can tell you in four words. Vishwamitra crossed the rivers with his army. That's it. But the way they have enriched him, the whole incident is more important. And for me, this sukta, why I like the most is, I must tell you that story before I take my break. Long back, in 84, 85, I don't remember, but sometime in 80s, our family went for that typical vacation, you know, Simla, Kulu, Manali and all that. So we had a taxi, we were traveling and at some point we got hungry. So it was some place called Sundar Nagar. And he said, there was only a dirty restaurant, but there was no choice. So we went there and ate. And while I was eating, I asked that man, is there anything worth seeing here? He said, no, there is nothing. Of course, the village was itself very dirty and all. He said, but if you go ahead, there is one place called Harike Patan or Patan, where there is a confluence of Bias and Satluj. I said, are you kidding? He said, no, ma'am, really. And then we went there. I told my family, hurry up. We have to go and visit this place. We went there. For them, you know, it was only a small confluence, nothing more than that. Sangam. And as they started walking on the sands, I said, take out your shoes. How can you walk on the sand where Vishwamitra himself walked along with his army? How can you walk on that? I mean, it's a really an auspicious place, you know. It's a sacred place. And I tell you, I thought that again, I am connected to Rigveda. in real terms, you know, I felt connected to Rig Veda. All this time it was only on academic level, on mental and emotional level, but really I thought, oh my God, I am treading on the same sand. I know it is not the same sand, please. But still, you know, you can imagine what happens to you. And this is how Rig Veda keeps coming back to you again and again. Now, if you don't mind, I'll just take 2 or 3 minutes break and come back.
तो गेला होता आता आला का तो जिओ मधन
व्हिडिओ क्वालिटी इज बॅड व्हिडिओ पिक्चर्स आर हेजी व्हिडिओ इज गोल
तो कुठे गेला आपला जिओ मध्ये पाठवलं आता जिओ लावून पाहतो जिओ कुठे
जिओ
तर नंबर असेल तो जिओ मध्येच गेला होता का
ठीक आहे येत आहे बघूया
आपलं कनेक्शन जरा घ्यायचं आहे फक्त जिओचं काय त्याचं
नाव आहे पोरगा आपलं सागर सागर
हा तो काय जिओ मध्ये जाऊन आला तर विचारू ना
Thank you.
So, you will realize that there are Samvada Suktas, there are philosophical Suktas, there is Jnana Sukta, historical Suktas, there is everything, you name it, and it is there in Rigveda. What we say about Mahabharata, Yadihasti Tadanyatra, Yannehasti Natatkvachit, is actually true also of Rigveda. And that is why Rigveda becomes very important. But this doesn't mean that Rigveda has only these beautiful suktas and all. There are some suktas which some are enigmatic, I would say. They are difficult to understand. And like I said yesterday, you know, I can give you the translations, but I cannot give you the meaning behind it. And that is very important. We don't want translations. We want to understand what the Rishi wants to say. And sometimes we are not able to do that. If you remember, even in Mahabharata, Vyasa has told Ganesha that I will say the shlokas, Anushtup shlokas for Mahabharata, and you will write down, but you will not write down unless and until you understand the meaning of each and every verse. So similarly, even here, there are some very enigmatic. For the first thing is, you know, the language. The language is different. I mean, even though you have done MA Sanskrit, but in say, grammar or Vedanta or something, it's difficult to understand Veda. Vedic Sanskrit and Vedic language is very different. Secondly, there are some subjects, you know, some topics which we are not exactly keen to relate to. For example, Yajna. Yesterday I told you that the entire ninth mandala is addressed to Pavamana Soma, the Soma juice which is being filtered. Can you imagine so many suktas after suktas? I mean, people are just describing this flow of Soma and saying, oh, you are so beautiful. Oh, you are so beautiful. When will I partake of you? When they are only interested in having that, having their share of Soma rasa. Then there are some suktas. Actually, I must tell you one thing. I have studied Rigveda since 1967. Not once have we learnt a sukta from the ninth mandala. No university wants to keep it for the curriculum. Just as they don't keep anything from Yajurveda Samhita, they don't keep anything from the ninth mandala because they are really monotonous, you know. And sometimes you don't want to study them at all. So there are suktas which are addressed entirely to yajna. Now see what happens is yajna at that time was very important. It was the pivot around which the entire society revolved. But now it has no significance. Now it has no meaning at all. And therefore they become outdated. But apart from these ninth mandala suktas, and there are some suktas called apri. They are called apri suktas. They are used only in a pashu yajna, animal sacrifice. And they also become outdated because we don't perform these yajnas anymore. And that is why such suktas are sometimes very, I should use this word, I can't say boring, but sometimes we stop taking interest in them. But there are some suktas, and I must mention this particular mandala, seventh mandala by Vasishtha. Vasishtha by far is the greatest rishi in Rigveda. I told you yesterday that I was fortunate to be a student of Dr. R. N. Dandekar. I mean, that was the great thing that happened in my life. Not only for MA, but even he was my PhD advisor. And when he taught us seventh mandala, we really fell in love with seventh mandala and Vasishtha. The first thing Dr. Dandekar said, I don't know whether any one of you have met him, and you, of course, you have. So you know how he was. The first thing he said to our class, we were MA students, no one was about 20. He stood up and he said, we are going to learn the mandala by Vasishtha, who was the greatest amongst them. I am a Vasishtha too. And like him, I am Niputrika too. And that was, oh my God, we didn't know how to react to this sentence. I mean, we didn't know him, anything about his personal life, but I know for sure that Dandekars are Vasishtha Gotra people, for the simplest reason that he told us. And even in those days, there was this rivalry. You will be surprised. The Vasishtha, now I'm coming back to this seventh mandala and third mandala, which is by Vishwamitra. There is so much rivalry because in this famous war of Dasharadnya, 10 kings. Vasishtha was the senani of the 10 kings. Vishwamitra was the senani of Bharatas, as we saw just now. And they were rivals. I mean, naturally, you can imagine, enemies. They were not only rivals, they were enemies of each other. And Vasishtha uses curses and abuses against Vishwamitra. Vishwamitra does the same thing for him. And then Vishwamitra says, oh, this Vasishtha, they won the war, you know. It was like match fixing. It was a foul, you know. What they did was they used black magic. So that's an insult to Vasishtha, you know. And he says, adya muriya yadiya tudhanosmi. If I have really used black magic, I will die just now. I mean, just see the kind of rivalry they have. They fight with each other even in the Rigvedic suktas. And this rivalry, it's so alive. Again, see how it brings us back today. That even today, a boy from a Vasishtha Gotra cannot marry a girl from a Vishwamitra Gotra. Or otherwise, I mean, a boy and a girl, they cannot marry each other. And what I like the most is, imagine this rivalry has percolated for 5,000 years and they still don't marry. But that apart, Vasishtha writes the best poetry in Rigveda. There is absolutely no doubt about that. He defines poetry, he defines mantra. And at one point in one of the suktas, he says, mantram akharvam suditam supeshasam. He says, what is a mantra? Mantra is akharva. It should not be too long. Short, not too short either, but it should not be too long. Suditam, it must be well laid. The design must be good. And supeshas, is form. It must be beautiful. And so this is how, what his idea of poetry is. He talks about this Dasharatnya war in details, which is a boon in disguise, because we come to know a lot about Vedic history only through the descriptions of Dasharatnya Yudha. I will not go into details about that. I'm really scared how I'm going to cover all this in only 5 days, you know. But anyway, let's try. So what he says is, Vasishtha says is, he gives you the names of those 10 kings who fought. So you know that much history. He gives the names of all those Pancha Janaha, as they are called. Puru, Yadu, Anudru, Yu, Turvashu. Notice that they are all U ending. Puru, Yadu, Anu, Druyu, and Turvashu. In Sanskrit, we have very few names which are U ending, except Bhanu or some other thing. But in those days, like we have in Jnaneshwari, all the words end in U, similarly in Rigveda also. So anyway, Vasishtha talks about that, but the best part about Vasishtha's poetry is his relationship with his father. And you know who is his father? Varuna. Varuna is his father, and he talks about Varuna so beautifully. I'll tell you a couple of examples. He says, something has happened. Vasishtha is aware of what he has done, what wrong he has done, but he knows that Varuna is not talking to him. And he says, I tell him so many times, but he doesn't talk to me. Samanamitme kavayaschidahu ayam hatubhyam varuno runite. All these wise people in the world, kavi is a wise people, kavi is not poet in Rigveda. Kavim kavinam upamashravasam. So all these wise people, they tell me that we don't know why, but you know, he is angry with you, and that is why he doesn't talk to you. And then Vasishtha wants to please him. And he wants to go back to his father and have all that love and affection. So he tells him, and this verse is so beautiful. I think it's 786. Kvatyani nau sakhyani babhuvu. Where is that friendship of ours? Sakhya. I translate this as friendship. But where is that love between the two of us, which both of us shared for so many years? Where is that? Do you remember? I mean, this is Vasishtha talking to Varuna. He says, do you remember? You took me once to your house. And how was the house? Sahasradvaram, Bruhat, Manam. We say later on, we say Vimana. Here they use the word Mana. And Bruhat Mana, a very huge house which had 1,000 doors. Take it metaphorically. What he wants to say is, you lived in such a wonderful house. You took me there and now you don't talk to me. Why? What is wrong? And then he says, once I remember, O Varuna, that you took me in a Navi. Navi a Adhat. You put me in a boat. And both of us went for a boat ride in Samudra. He uses the word Samudra. Let's say it's a big river. I don't know where exactly they went. And he said the river, there was breeze. And it felt like Divi Prenkham. Prenkha is a swing. Jopala. And I felt like I am sitting on a swing. And we had such a wonderful time. What happened to that? Where is that affection? Where is that love for me? And you should not be angry. After that, what Vasishtha says is very important. He says, Nasasvo Dakshaha Varuna Dhruti Sa. Varuna, I did not do it purposely. This is what we all say, and now our children say this to us. It just happened. It happened, you know, inadvertently or something. Varuna Dhruti Saha, and then he gives 4 reasons why a mistake can happen from anyone, even as great as Vasishtha. And he says, you know what he said? Sura manyuhu vibhitakaha achitti. This happened inadvertently, Or maybe, you know, I was under the influence of Sura and I didn't know what I was doing. Or maybe Manyu is krodh, anger. Or maybe I was angry. And when you are angry, you always say things which you don't want to say. Or you don't mean exactly what they say. So maybe it was Manyu. Vibhitaka is this aksha. Or maybe I was playing dice. And when you said something, I didn't hear or something. And the last word is wonderful. Achittihi. Chitta is mind. My mind was not working properly, you know, this happens. Sometimes you yourself repent afterwards that why did I say this? Or why did I do that? Because my mind was not working properly. And therefore he says, please excuse me. And there are verses after verses where the refrain, the last line is Mrula Sukshatra Mrulaya. Please have compassion on me and love me one more time. This is the best example of bhakti, almost as good a bhakti, sir, as Varkari Sampradaya or Bhagavata Sampradaya would have, where the devotee is talking to his deity or God on the same level. And therefore, Vasishtha's poetry is very beautiful. Vasishtha has written some wonderful suktas. One of them, again, I cannot just refrain from quoting it. It is called Manduka Sukta. Manduka is frogs. Kupa Manduka Vrutti. We use all these words. So Manduka is frogs. And if I tell you that Vasishtha in Rigveda wrote a sukta on frogs, what will be your reaction? First thing is, you won't believe me. I mean, where there is Purusha Sukta and Hiranyagarbha Sukta and Jnana Sukta, Aksha Sukta, Indra Sukta, how can you have a Sukta on Mandukas? You will not believe. Vasishtha, this is called self-parody. He cracks a joke on himself, not himself, but all the Brahmins who chant Rigveda, the oral tradition. And in a very healthy way, it takes a great courage and magnanimity of mind to crack a joke on yourself. And he says, Samvat Sarams, for a whole year, they were sleeping, the Mandukas, the frogs. They were just sleeping, you know, hibernation. And he describes them, he says, Drutim da Shushkam Sarasi Shayana. For 1 year, like a Shushka Druti, like a dry leather bag, they were sleeping in the lake, but advent of rain and they suddenly start croaking. They start chanting as if. And how do they chant? They have different tones. One goes this way, one goes that way. This doesn't matter. Shaktasya iva vadati shaktamanaha shikshamanaha. Just as shikshamanaha, a student follows after the teacher, one frog, the lead frog, whosoever, whatever it is called, he starts croaking and then everybody joins in. Everybody joins in. He describes them. Gomayurekaha, Jamayurekaha. There is one whose color is like that of a cow. There is another who is like Aja, that is Avi, sheep. So he describes them and says that they are like Brahmins who chant Vedas. Can you believe? Again, what I said yesterday about the Labha Sukta or Indrani Sukta. One thing is, Vasishtha has the courage to write this and Shakala has the courage to include it in Rigveda. He could have easily done away with it. That, oh, this is something, you know, it's a criticism on Brahmins. But that's what I want you to know. That here, even though he says Brahmana, it does not refer to a caste. It refers to people who recite Brahman, that is mantra. And therefore, all these beautiful suktas from 7th mandala are really wonderful. Yesterday, I don't know whether I wrote that in my CV, but you know, just as I am grateful to my teachers who gave all this knowledge to me, I am also grateful to many of my students, you know. And you know that students, in fact, you know, they make you you are always on your toes because there are good students and good audience in front of you. Srinand is not here today. Okay. Srinand Bapat, most of you know him. So his mother, at a late stage in her life, she was a teacher in Ahilya Devi, I think. And they all decided to do MA Sanskrit with Veda. And I was teaching them 7th mandala, Vasishtha mandala. After the exams, they came to meet me and said, oh, it was wonderful, this, that, we got these many marks. And Srinand's mother told me that, man, we have built a small house. All these years, it was anonymous. There was no name on it. But I have convinced my family that I must name it as Vasishtha. And I thought, oh my God, that is such a great tribute to Rigveda. That is such a great tribute to Vasishtha himself. And there is one more story which I must tell you. And here I'm going to use the caste name also. There was one student, I will not tell you his name, but his caste was Mang. And he was doing MA Sanskrit with Veda as a principal. All of those who have some objection that, oh, Sanskrit is a monopoly of fistful of people and 3.5% of Brahmin, whatever. But I want them to know that it is not so. We see on WhatsApp and on how foreigners, and they are not Brahmins just because they are foreigners. So they also learn Vedas. Similarly, he also learned Vedas. And then he had a small house. After 4 or 5 years after he passed out, he came and he said, ma'am, I have built a house, again a house. And I want you to come and open the, something like an opening ceremony for the name of the house. I said, okay, I'll come. I mean, I didn't know what it was. He didn't tell me. I went there and there was only a piece of paper, you know, stuck on a wall. And he said, you have to tear it off. It was that simple. But the name of the house was Madhuchandas, which is the name of the Rishi who wrote Agni Mile Purohitam. I mean, this is something I feel that how Rigveda goes right up to you even today. So many students of mine, one student has her name, Sunila's daughter is named Samhita. Lina, there was one student whose daughter is named Gayatri. And they have all done, here comes Srinand. You came 2 minutes late. Anyway, so this is how Rigveda continues in your life even today. That is what I want to say. There is one very important thing I want to tell you. I have talked on Rigveda for last hour and a half or so, hour at least. And yesterday also I talked about Rigveda. But believe me, I have not even covered 1/100th of what Rigveda has to offer. Things which I have not said, please don't assume that they are not there in the Rigveda. They are very much there. The unfortunate thing is, you know, we have some time constraints and we must follow that. Before I move to my other topic, which I just want to start today, introduce kind of, I want to tell you that all of those who want to study more about Rigveda, or for that matter, Upanishad, Brahmana, which we are going to do now, there are some wonderful books. Especially, I can see that most of you know Marathi well, right? So I would suggest that go to any library, it's definitely there in Bhandarkar Institute, and read Bharatiya Sanskriti Kosh by Tarkatirtha Mahadev Shastri Joshi. Mahadev Shastri Joshi, not Lakshman. And then later on, his daughter also joined him, Tarkatirtha Padmaja Hodarkar. Yeah. And they are amazing texts. Bharatiya Sanskriti Kosh, which is popularly known amongst the students as Bhasanko. And nobody refers to that as, please give me one volume number one, please give me volume number two. People say, मॅम कॅन यू गिव्ह मी कंक ते गावडा. सो द फर्स्ट वर्ड इज कंक, द लास्ट वर्ड इज गावडा. सो पीपल नो इवन दॅट बाय हार्ट, यू नो. सो दीज आर वंडरफुल बुक्स. अँड वॉट इज व्हेरी इम्पॉर्टंट इज वन्स यू स्टार्ट रिडिंग दॅट देर इज बिब्लिओग्राफी. सो इट विल गिव्ह यू मोर बुक्स. अँड ऑफकोर्स देर आर बुक्स इन इंग्लिश विच आर देअर टू. देर आर ट्रान्सलेशन्स अँड वंडरफुल बुक्स. आय वूड ऑल्सो लाईक ऑल ऑफ यू इफ पॉसिबल टू रीड अ बुक कॉल वैदिक संस्कृतीचे पैलू बाय प्रोफेसर काशीकर. दॅट इज अन अमेझिंग बुक. अँड ऑफकोर्स देर आर मेनी बुक. आय मीन देर इज नो डर्थ ऑफ बुक्स ऑन वैदिक लिटरेचर ॲट ऑल, बट दीज आर सम ऑफ द बेसिक वन्स आय वूड लाईक यू टू डू. आय हॅव 10 मिनिट्स. आय टोल यू दॅट टाईम इज रनिंग शॉर्ट अँड आय डिसायडेड दॅट इन्स्टेड ऑफ टुमॉरो I will start talking about Yajurveda right now. So I also told you that Rugveda is full of poetry, ruks, which is all verse, right? It's ruchas, that is verse form. There is no prose in Rugveda. And not all of it is focused or directed to yajna only. You have seen how many different topics are there. So what happens is, later on, you know, six systems of Indian philosophy. There are six systems of Indian philosophy. One of them is Purva Mimamsa. And Mimamsa says, Veda hi yajnyartham abhipravruttaha. All the Vedas are written only for their use in yajna. That's their view. It is not so. We have seen that. Secondly, if you remember, when we started yesterday about knowing about the various suktas, I told you this verse, Avidhitva Rushim Chando Devatam Yoga Mevacho. And yoga was Vini Yoga, the use of a particular rook in a yajna. So whatever, I also talked about Soma, Pavamana Soma. I also talked about this Apri Suktas. And many other suktas which are related to yajna. It so happens that yajna became more and more important. And people were performing yajnas. Just as Rugveda is a collection of ruks through which we get Veda, that is knowledge. Yajurveda is a collection of yajus through which we get knowledge mainly about yajna. And what is a yajus? We at least have heard the word ruk sometimes, you know. But yajus we don't know. Yajus is a prose formula used in a yajna. It is called Gadya Mantra, but it is actually a prose formula used in a mantra. It is very drab, dry. The only thing it has is some connection with that particular yajna, whichever it could be. Kariri-ishti, Parjanya-ishti, or Ashwamedha, Vajapeya, whatever. All these things, as yajnas, the institution of yajna grew a lot, all these prose formulas, there was a need to compile them and put them in one Veda or one text, Samhita. And that is how Yajurveda came into being. So Yajurveda is entirely an artificial text. Why I say artificial? It doesn't come from the heart of the rishis, you know. It is there only to say, okay, so this is Vajapeya. So I list all the yajus that I will use right from beginning to the end. That's about it. It is called liturgical samhita. Liturgical is that which is related only to liturgy or only to yajna. So it is not, there is no poetry. There is not much meaning either, but it is still important. Again, like I said about ninth mandala, there is anywhere in the university curriculum, there is no text from Yajurveda Samhita. There is from Shatapatha Brahmana and all, but not from Samhita. And this Yajurveda is, even Rugveda has many shakha. Or is, we say branches is not something which I like, the schools of Rigveda. Similarly, Yajurveda has two major schools. One is called Shukla Yajurveda, the other is called Krishna Yajurveda. Nothing to do with the color. But, I mean, this apartheid is seen everywhere, you know, all over the world, even in the literature. And so what is Shukla Yajurveda? Shukla Yajurveda is something which is pure, which means there is compilation only of the prose formulas, nothing else. Whereas Krishna Yajurveda has the formulas and then some explanation on those formulas as well. That is why it is called Krishna Yajurveda. That is something which is not pure Samhita, but there is some explanation also. Shukla Yajurveda, even Krishna Yajurveda has many schools, but Shukla Yajurveda, I'm more interested in that because we're going to talk a lot about that later, tomorrow maybe. And there are two schools again in Shukla. One is called Kanva and the other is called Mandyandina. I learned this in college, that there are two schools of Shukla Yajurveda, and I forget, I mean, I let it be at that. Most of us don't even know to which Veda you belong, do you know? Most of you don't know that, to be frank. Once I was invited by one Brahmana Sabha to give a talk, and it was a Brahmana Sabha belonging to Madhyandina Shaka of Shukla Yajurveda in Pune. And I thought, oh my God. So there are at least some people who know whether they belong to Rigveda or Yajurveda. Even in Yajurveda, do they know whether they belong to Shukla or Krishna? And even in Shukla, they know for sure that they belong to Madhyandina or Kanva, whatever. So just see that even today, this distinction of schools is followed in our society. It is followed in our society, and I think you can't do away with that. I'm not promoting anything. I'm not recommending anything. I'm just pointing out the fact that all these things stay with you forever. That's about all. Today, I just wanted to introduce Yajurveda. From tomorrow, we will do Yajurveda, Samaveda, and Atharva Veda, the remaining three Vedas. Like yesterday, if you have any questions, you can go ahead.
वेगळे पॉइंट्स आहेत पण तरी ते एकत्र करता येते. काल आपण पेरेंटिंग हा एक छोटासा विषय टच केला होता आणि आज सोशल त्याचं हे कसं असायला पाहिजे. सो इथे दोन गोष्टी एकत्र करून असं मला हे करायचं की आपण आत्ता हे संस्कृत वगैरे आपण म्हणतो की खूप लोकांना माहिती नाही आहे पण तरीही आजची परिस्थिती काय आहे की लाईक पेरेंटिंग कसं असायला पाहिजे पुढच्या पिढीचं हे सुद्धा खूप महत्त्वाची गोष्ट आहे. तर आपण त्यासाठी काही करू शकतो का की जेणेकरून आपल्या पुढच्या पिढ्या चांगल्या मार्गाने जातील किंवा ते
हा प्रश्न अगदीच वेगळा आहे. म्हणजे मला वाटतं की
याच्यात येऊ शकेल
असं याच्या कक्षेत येतोय असं मला वाटत नाही. पण तरी मी एक म्हणेन की जर तुम्हाला चांगलं पेरेंटिंग व्हायचं म्हणजे करायचं असेल आपल्या मुलांचं प्रबोधन ज्याला म्हणतो ते करायचं असेल तर आधी आपलं केलं पाहिजे ना.
ऑफकोर्स त्यासाठी
आणि त्याच्यासाठी निदान भासंको तरी वाचलाच पाहिजे. सो तेवढं वाचलं तरी आपल्याला मग कॉन्फिडन्स येतो.
इट्स लाईक मला असं हे करायचंय की आपण आपल्या पुढच्या पिढ्यांना कसं चांगलं हे करू शकतो त्यासाठी पहिल्यांदा पेरेंटिंग चांगलं असलं पाहिजे हे दोन मुद्दे मला एकत्र करायचे.
बरोबर आहे.
आणि त्यासाठी मग ते सोशलायझेशन कसं व्हायला पाहिजे सो हाऊ वी कॅन मेक इट पॉसिबल की ते लोकांपर्यंत पोहोचेल आणि त्याप्रमाणे आपल्याला इतकं चांगल्या गोष्टी आपल्या ऋषीने सांगून ठेवलेल्या आहेत आणि त्या पुढे आपण खरंच त्या इम्प्लिमेंट करू शकतो का. कारण मला असं बोलणं खरं चुकीचं वाटतं मला हे की पेरेंटिंग चांगलं व्हायला पाहिजे ते खूप लोकांच्याकडे दिसत नाही. पण
पण ऑनेस्टली आय थिंक दिस इज बियॉन्ड परव्ह्यू ऑफ दिस टॉक यु नो. नो नो इट्स ओके. बट आता ह्याच्याबद्दल बोलणं मला प्रशस्त वाटत नाही.
सोशलाइज
मॅडम तुम्ही देवताबद्दल सांगितलं, माझा आतापर्यंत असा समज होता की देवता म्हणजे गॉडेस, जे थोडक्यात देव म्हणजे गॉड आणि देवता म्हणजे गॉडेस, किंवा थोडस व्यापक स्वरूप दिलं तर जे पूजनीय असतं ते देवता. परंतु जेव्हा तुम्ही ते अक्ष सुक्त वगैरे सांगितलं तर त्याच्यामध्ये तुम्ही अक्ष देवता देखील म्हणालात, तर आता अक्ष म्हणजे डाईस किंवा गॅम्बलिंग आणि डेफिनेटली हे काय पूजनीय तर नाहीये, आणि त्यामुळे मग देवता म्हणजे जस्ट इट इज नॉट बेसिकली समथिंग विच इज टू बी वर्शिप, और इट इज जस्ट सब्जेक्ट मॅटर ऑफ दॅट
पोएट्री. इफ यू रिमेंबर काल मी हेही सांगितलं की ऋषी देवता यांच्या डेफिनेशन काय आहेत त्या आपण काल पाहिल्या. यस्य वाक्यम स ऋषी, द वन हु कंपोजिस इट इज कॉल्ड अ ऋषी, या तेन उच्यते सा देवता. Whatever he talks about is devata, and I think I made it very clear ki devata manje tya suktacha varnya vishay. We should not confuse devata with dev ani devi. Devi is a goddess.
Manje devata manje devata always pujaniya aselas asa nahi.
Nahi. Manje at least for Rugveda it is not.
Yes. Yes.
At least for Rugveda.
Yeah. Ani dusra maje ek manje mala thoda sa ek वाईल्ड थॉट आलं मनामध्ये, जेव्हा तुम्ही कवी म्हणजे वाईज मॅन म्हटल्या की कवी म्हणजे पोएट नाही, तर कवी म्हणजे इट इज जस्ट वाईल्ड थॉट, म्हणजे प्लीज एक्सक्यूज मी, त्याचा अर्थ तसा घेत कवी म्हणजे मग असं की त्याच जो ज्याच्या कवीत सगळं येतं त्यामुळे तो कवी का असा अर्थ होऊ शकतो
तसं नाही. कवेत हा मराठी शब्द झाला, कवी हा वैदिक संस्कृत शब्द.
थँक्यू थँक्यू.
नमस्ते मॅम. Towards the end of Suri Mandal Stotra, there comes a mention of Krishna Arjuna Samvada. So is that...
Wait.
Suri Mandal Stotra, towards the end of it.
Surya Mandala Stotra.
Yeah.
I heard Sukta and I said, where does Krishna Arjuna comes there?
Huh. So is that part of this Samvada Sukta?
It is not. It is not included in the Vedic literature at all. Vedic literature doesn't know Krishna as a god. Vedic literature doesn't know Arjuna at all. No.
Then which, to which this belongs to?
It comes from Mahabharata onwards, you know, Krishna, out of hero worship, he became God. And mostly, more than Mahabharata, it is the appendix, which is called Harivamsha, which tells you all these stories about Krishna and Arjuna and all those things.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Chetana? He wants to say something.
There are quite a few waiting.
Yeah,
just,
but...
Yeah, just a minute. Apan Shastrijinsa now, Mallata. Apan Ghanapath Manara, Shastrijinsa now, Mallata, Yedurkar Shastri.
Haan, Yedurkar, right.
Athani cha zavad kya hote
kaan? Parabane. मी येरवडेकर म्हणत होते, म्हणून मी तेव्हा देगलूरकर सरांकडेही पाहिलं की मला काहीतरी आठवत होतं, पण माझी स्मृती त्यांच्या इतकी चांगली नाही त्यामुळे मी गोंधळ केला. पण येडूरकर शास्त्रीज बरोबर, अगदी बरोबर,
कारण ते कोयनाला आले होते 1964 सुमाराला, तेव्हा मी त्यांचं ऐकलं.
हा करेक्ट, येडूरकर.
दुसरं काल आपण भाष्कल शाखाबद्दल म्हटलं तर भाष्कल उपनिषद आहे आणि त्या भाष्कल उपनिषदामध्ये इंद्रानी मेषरूप घेतलं आणि मेधातिथीचं अपहरण केलं होतं,
हो
ती एक आख्यायिका आहे,
हो
ती त्या अर्धवट उपनिषद पण वाचनीय. तिसरं आपण आयसी शब्द म्हणला होता,
आयसी जंघा,
तर इतरय उपनिषदामध्ये वामदेव म्हणतात की मी या जन्ममृत्यूच्या लोखंडी पिंजऱ्यातून सुटलो, तिथं आयसी शब्द आलेला आहे.
आलेला आहे पण उपनिषद नंतरची आहेत ना, त्यामुळे वेदात आला हेच नंतर नंतर तर कृष्णाय असं आणि ताम्राय असं, म्हणजे कॉपर अँड स्टील असे दोन्ही वेगळे शब्द पण यायला लागतात.
आणखी नव्या मंडळात शेवटच्या सूक्तामध्ये एक जे ऋचा आहे ती शंकराचार्यांनी त्यांच्या शतश्लोकीमध्ये सुद्धा घेतली आहे आणि तिथे सोम म्हणजे हा सोमरसा आनंद आहे आणि आनंद हा स्रवतो म्हणजे आज्ञाचक्राच्या वगैरे चलून हे जे योगामध्ये सांगितलेलं आहे ते त्या तिथे सांगितलेले आहे आणि ते ज्ञानेश्वरीमध्ये सुद्धा जे चांदण म्हणून आलेलं आहे ते आनंद रूपच आहे.
बरोबर आहे. आपण काल विवाह संस्थाबद्दल काही बोलणार होतात का?
ऐकू की विसरले ना.
नाही म्हणजे इफ यू वॉन्ट टू इन्क्लूड इट टुमॉरो असं काय जस्ट
दोन तीन मिनिटात बोलू का?
देन मे बी क्वेश्चन्स कॅन बी टेकन लेटर बिकॉज दिस इज.
थँक्यू. Vedas are called
Shruti. You must have heard the word Shruti. And Shrauta is everything related to Vedas. And all knowledge, as I told you, came from oral transmission. People only heard it. And that is why in India, even today, when there is a learned man, we don't say he is a well-read person. We say he is Bahu Shruta. So there are two things, Shruti and Smruti. And Smruti is memory. And unfortunately, my Smruti is not as good as yours. Thank you for reminding me. So Vivaha Sukta, yesterday I only mentioned it. But the very fact that there is a Sukta dedicated entirely to a social institution called Vivaha is important for its social implication. Okay? And there is this Vivaha of one Surya. Okay? It is not Surya, not a man. It is Surya. And the commentators tell you, no, just imagine this. I won't go into details. But Surya is the light of sun which is reflected on the moon. Can you believe that? That they talk about that light as Surya and then they talk about her wedding, her marriage. Okay? And then they say there was a condition. For every Swayamvara, there is some condition. And the condition was everybody had to go running in a chariot, driving a chariot, and one who reaches the first will get the Surya and then they get him. The most important thing is there are some mantras which are used in that Vivaha Sukta. For example, there is this mantra called Grumnamite Saubhagatvaya Hastam. I don't know whether you all remember, but when we got married, the priest would tell us that keep your thumb here and then the husband holds your hand. This is to get a son, whatever. But this is called, in fact, Pani Grahana. Pani is hand, as you know. So this mantra comes from Rig Veda and which is used even today. This is more important to me. And there are many other mantras, but this is the only one I would say. Secondly, the relationship between husband and wife is clearly and beautifully seen in this Vivaha Sukta. Here the husband tells the wife, Ihaivashtav ma viyaushtam kridantav putrair naptrubhi. Stay here in this house forever. Ma viyaushtam, don't leave me ever. And we will play not only with Naptru, but even great-grandchildren. And he says, Asmin Gruhe Garhapatyaya Jagruhi. You stay here and look after Garhapatya. The best translation of Garhapatya is Samsar, Marathitla Samsar. So let us do that Garhapatya happily in this house. More important than that, for what I find is, he says, let us be samana, samana manaha. And that is very important. Who cares about samana manaha these days? They just look at the jobs. They look at their career profile or something. I have seen, in fact, one of my nephews, when he was getting married, he said, Mommy, I have made my profile ready. You can go through that. I said, what profile? He said, for the wedding. So that the girls will see that. So they are interested in profile. What do you earn? How much do you earn? Where do you go? They are not interested in whether your hearts and your minds are on the same level. But Rig Veda is. And that is very important. When we do Atharva Veda, I will also tell you more about this. But now that you have reminded me, I would like to tell you one wonderful thing about Rig Veda. we started with Agni Mide Purohitam, remember? And now the last Sukta of Rig Veda, which is 10th Mandala, 191st. I told you that first and last both have 191 Suktas in it. And that is amazing. Every day I say that. I would just chant two ruchas for you, and they are Sangachadvam, Samvadadvam, Samvo Manavsi Janatam, Deva Bhagam Yatha Purve, Sanjanana Upasate. He says, Sangachadvam, go together. Samvadadvam, speak together. That is, let there be harmony amongst you. Sangachadvam samvadadvam samvo manavsi janatam. The most difficult thing. He expresses the hope that you will understand each other's minds. Can you believe that? And then later on, the next one, he says, samaniva akutihi samana rudhayanivaha. You can guess the meaning now. Akutihi is sankalpa. Whatever your intentions are, let them be same. I mean, he's talking about your dear and near ones. So let them be same. Samaniva akutihi samana rudhayanivaha samanam astu vo manaha. Let our mind be the same. Yathavas susaha asati. So that this life will be bearable. So the last verse of the Rig Veda, the last Rucha of Rig Veda, does not ask for sons, does not ask for gems and jewels, not cows either. It asks for harmony amongst men. And therefore, I call that verse Vaidik Pasayana, because that is precisely what it is. And I would like you to chant or say these two ruchas every day. It makes amazing chanting. That's all I would say. It depends on how much effect it has on your psyche, but it is good. So this is what about Vivaha Sukta. I had to, of course, wind up because it's already 7 o'clock, but thank you for reminding. And see you tomorrow to learn more about the other three Vedas.
Thank you so much, Sukhita Bhai. I'm sure there will be
many more questions, and time is always going to be a problem. And I know every time it happens, the speaker starts telling